We have about 20 more months, 20 more months to go in phase four training, phase four practice. This takes us into June of 2016. We want to be done sometime by June of 2016. We want to be finished with our phase four practicing. This is, so 20 more months, 20 more months. So far, so good. But we need to accelerate the entire situation, actually. So let that sink in. Just let it sink in. 20 more months. And a sense of urgency is super important. What's taking place in this world is, to put it in very simple terms, a repackaging of delusion. Okay, a repackaging of delusion. This is called the next cycle. The next cycle is just working on repackaging delusion. That's all. And if you know what delusion's all about, you don't want to spend your time repackaging delusion. That's just non-negotiable, off the table, forget it. But by, as we go into July of 2016, this repackaging effort of delusion will seem like the reality of this planet. And anything else will seem to be criminal. Okay. It will, we've already been through, you know, several decades of criminalization of the spiritual path in this planet. In many, many subtle ways, some not so subtle. For instance, you cannot wear any symbol to school. And now, even in public, people are, you're being shamed, everybody's being shamed. Don't have any indication of any spiritual path whatsoever. Path of liberation from nature, from determinancy, which is, from the effort to change what we are, which is totally indeterminate. So, of course, the effort to change what we are means to make ourselves determinate, means not free. So, of course, we are dwelling in this nature, which is totally, seems totally locked into determinancy and cycles, and we can't do anything about it, really, you know? This is an attempt to change what we are. So just to repackage this, as if repackaging it makes it true, is exercising futility, to say the least. And this is what's this next cycle, the cycles are all about. The packagers come in, the repackagers come in, and they repackage it. And anybody who doesn't go along with it, they criminalize it. They blackmail as many people as possible to be, don't say anything about this, you know. No path to liberation, no path to realize we're indeterminate, no path to freedom, no way to set down this dream, no way to awaken from it, you know. What dream? They say, we're repackaging it, everything's okay. So the repackaging efforts are going to be so extreme. They already are extreme, but it's going to be criminal to not repackage it. Okay, it's going to be criminal to not repackage it. That's the UN resolution that was passed lately. is this draconian foundation, which already there's so many, 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 many laws trickling down. And the repackagers will be seen as untouchable, cannot criticize them. They become the new, you know, Fuhrer, the Politburo of the world, where you cannot criticize them. Like in the Soviet Union, you could criticize the Politburo, in totalitarian regimes, you can't criticize the regime. It's punishable by death, actually. It's the worst thing you can do. And so what we have now is this, the repackagers are here in this world, and they're becoming sacrosanct, completely sacrosanct. You can't say anything, you cannot criticize, you cannot evaluate, you cannot point out what they're doing. It's all being criminalized, actually. So by July of 2016, the overall weight of this criminalization, this blackmailing and criminalization, will just submerge those who have not really prepared for indeterminacy. It'll be too much to bear at that point. This is at least the heads up that I've gotten. This is the sense that I have. It's already almost too much to bear, actually. So we need now just this huge blast of indeterminacy coming onto the scene right now. The New World Religion is this repackaging effort. And they'll put all sorts of jewelry in the frame of this, you know, to make it glittering and make it look seem attractive and all, but that's the same old, same old, same old. That's what's always been happening. So we have 20 months, and I'm calling out all those allies of indeterminacy, wherever they are, to come on the scene now, wherever they are, formless, dimensionless, other dimensions, other places, here, wherever, with no strings attached, where they need to, so-called, wherever they are, they could be everywhere, as it were, come out of the woodwork, you know, and let's have this huge boost of indeterminacy for those who are graduating now. The upperclassmen, the senior class, should have access to previous graduates. You see, this is what's happened with me, is finally getting to the senior class, the graduating class. I have had contacts with those who have already graduated, graduates, advising me and giving me encouragement. This is how it should be. And in a culture of spiritual attainment, the graduating class should be sharing this with the other classes, saying, look, this is what you have to look forward to, and don't worry, you will get help in order to graduate when you get to the upper class. This is the stream of transmission. Okay, it's very important. This is what's being sabotaged at this time. As I pointed out, by the corporate princess culture and the sacrosanct repackagers. You know there's all sorts of groups that are sacrosanct right now. Those are the repackagers. Those are ones that are coming in and saying, hey, you know, forget about the what's in the package, delusion. Forget about that. Let's just repackage it, and then that should take care. You shouldn't have any problems then. That's not really thought out very well, is it? Not any reason at work there. Their thing is, shh, don't bring reason in here. There's lack of reason at work here in the world. Lack of reason at work. And they don't want any reason to be apparent. People say, hey, what's that? I like that. That's a reason, huh? Let me try that. No, they don't want that. So 20 months. That's not that long, right? Get through that in a hurry. So again, let's call all the allies of indeterminacy. We're calling on all the allies of indeterminacy right now. Bring it. Let's start having experiences of indeterminacy. I had a dream. I was in an elevator. Went into an elevator, and I was with some friend or someone, and I got into the elevator. There's a bunch of other people in the elevator, and the elevator doors closed. And people were saying, what floor are you going to? And I said, 0, 2, 1, you know, down to the ground floor or whatever, basement. And suddenly I realized my friend was not in the elevator, and the doors, all these doors, so I pushed the inner door, grabbed them, tried to pull it open, there was another one, I was able to force all these doors open, and my friend came in the elevator. I said, wow, almost missed you. And I said, what floor? They said, 5. I said, 5? Nobody's going up to 5. Really? You're going up to 5? Wow. I said, that's great. It's like, you know, everybody was going down in the elevator. Everybody's going down. There's this one person who's going up to 5. Call it death-free realm, the 5th dimension. Pure land. So I was almost trapped in going down with all these other people. And I forced all the doors open and allowed this friend to come in who's going up to the fifth level, you see. That was a pretty amazing dream. And everybody was astonished, like, who's this guy? Like pulling up on all these doors, you know. But I was like, I cannot be separated from this friend, you know, they have to be here too. The repackagers can be very charming. I call them the brownies. You know, they're into the earth, the world. They can be dressed up in perky little outfits, looking very attractive, and talking about all the wonderful things, all the repackaging, what they're going to do, and how they're going to make this world so wonderful, and all this kind of stuff. And it's easy to be enthralled by them, actually. Very easy to be enthralled by these. Remember the Monterey Bay Aquarium, all these people that work there. They're so perky and happy and friendly and cute and just like, wow, you know, this world is just so absolutely amazing, isn't it? You're so blessed to be here. This is just incredible. How could you not be happy like I'm so happy? And I'm just so excited about being able to be here with these little squids here and little fish. Oh my gosh, this is just, you know, it's easy to get caught up in that. I didn't get caught up in it, but I had a dream last night where I was listening to this brownie who's just all bubbly about how, you know, I just like, and then I looked up and I said, wait a minute, you know, well, what is this? It's a repackaging effort, is what it is. It's a repackaging effort. And you know, it can seem like a real positive thing. You know, youth is here to repackage the world, folks. Isn't this wonderful? That's what the corporate princess culture is telling everybody, so that we continue to be enslaved and serve, you know, their agenda of trying to make this world our home. Trying to, as we wait for, well, we're trying to make this world our home, believing we can change what we are into something determinate. Twenty months. So how to use these 20 months, very important. Most people are oblivious to all this. They're simply, you know, don't have the will, don't have the determination, don't, you know, they haven't gone through the necessary consideration, so they're not able to withstand this repackaging effort, and they'll go through another cycle. and then of course, as that cycle winds down, there'll be another repackaging effort, and it just goes on and on and on and on like that. See, it just continues on like that. So there's no point where the world will not continually try to reinvent itself. There's all these cycles, and keep trying to reinvent, repackage. At some point, you have to say it doesn't matter what the repackaging is. It doesn't matter what the frame of the picture looks like. What's the picture? That's the only thing that's important. Now, the picture we have looking at this world is the picture of determinism. Determinism, which means one moment defines the next, and the next defines the next, has some role, some chain of causation. And this is delusion. This is the picture that we're looking at. It's a picture designed to try and change what we are. We're trying to change what we are, so just to see if we have the power to do so, really. That's really why we did it. To say, hey, do we have all power? I wonder if we have power to change what we are. And so we tried to do this. No harm, no foul. It's okay. And so we've tried to make a real beautiful frame around this, and say, oh, isn't it nice? Isn't it cute? How lovely? You know, this world so wonderful. the intermediate step to setting this down is supernature. And what supernature is very interesting. Supernature is like the picture is one of indeterminism. Indeterminism. Formless. Indeterminate. Okay. Indeterminate. But the frame is very beautiful too around this picture. So we're so used to looking at the frame, you see, of nature, thinking, oh yeah, this is beautiful, overlooking how horrible it is actually. The picture, determinism, is just hideous. So that we're not able to shift our attention from the frame to the picture just like that, actually. We need an intermediate step. So supernature is like, we make the frame just really super beautiful. And the picture itself is formless. So we're so used to looking at the frame, we just look at a different frame now. So, okay, the frame is now supernature. Wow, that's fantastic. And from that frame of supernature, we gradually are able to then look at the picture, which is formless, so to speak, which is what? The form of everything. What the picture, what the frame of supernature is framing is the clear light, which is the form of everything, which is all the forms of all forms, okay? Where everything is there. Everything that's there is the clear light. But we have a continuity problem in going from this picture of determinism to the clear light, you see. So we have this intermediate step of this new picture, which the frame is similar to the previous frame, but it's much more beautiful, actually. And that frame is so beautiful in the way it is made, the frame, that we're able to gradually look at the picture that it's framing, which is this the clear light of all. Everything is there. All potential, all potential, all potential form, all potential appearance, all potential experiencing, everything, all potential appearances are this. The form of that is this perfectly clear light with nothing intruding at all, you see, to catch your attention. Is this smooth, clear light, zero dimensionality, pure spaciousness. So, look at it that way. We're just getting a new frame and a new picture. But we're not, it's not demanded that we immediately look at the picture. This is how I see it. We can keep looking at the frame because that's what we're used to. So our continuity issue is solved this way. We just continue to look at the frame. Only now the frame is way more beautiful and way more lovely. Exquisite in a way that we can hardly explain, really. And yet it's still a frame around a picture. And the picture is the clear light. So the picture is not actually emptiness. It's complete fullness. Complete fullness. Clear light is not emptiness. It's total fullness. And in it, being used to determinism, going to complete fullness is just a mind freak. You know, it's just we cannot, it's a continuity jump that we're not willing to take for sure. So the new frame seems to sort of melt into this complete fullness. You know, it's sort of a gradation that seems to lead us into this complete fullness. Supernature, supernature, supernature. Now, can supernature reach the frame here in this world? Absolutely. Can it reach our perception? Absolutely. We're told that it can. Our perception can be shifted. Our attention can be shifted onto this new frame. And this new frame can seem to be melting out of this, the old frame too, the way that it's made. It's very, there's gradients involved in some way, yeah. So yes, we can, we're told that we can. issue with us. Maybe it's a little, but you'd say, wow, everything seems to be getting more ephemeral, very ephemeral. And there's a different feel about everything. But it's still a frame I'm looking at here. Okay, that's fine. I'm still not focused on content. But again, shifting from the content of this world, which is the belief in determinism, to the clear light is a huge continuity problem. So we're not forced to go directly into the content of this new picture. If we could do that, we wouldn't even need supernature at all. We'd vanish from here like that, actually, if we could do that. The absolute clear light abiding in that, you cannot maintain a form here in this world for very long at all. If that's your that's your attention is fully, completely, tracelessly there. So there's a pragmatism to the plan of salvation. And so by 2:16, 20 months from now, the plan of salvation will be persona non grata in this world. It's already very much that way. It's kind of like in any totalitarian situation that's coming upon the world. The laws are changed ahead of time. Organized bureaucracy is set up ahead of time. Detention centers are set up ahead of time. All this stuff is set up years in advance. And then at some point, the pogrom is put into place, the push is put into place. And you feel the weight of it, and somehow you really feel, oh wow, this is the weight is now really being brought to bear. So 20 months. Now this situation is worse than like a situation of losing your life. It's worse like than that, way worse. Because we're talking about deciding to reinvest in another cycle. You'll lose your life many times in the new cycle. You'll go through many struggles and sufferings and miseries and bizarrenesses. Trying to hold on to the packaging, thinking that that protects you from the content. It's terrible. So it's way worse than a pogrom to destroy bodies. This is a pogrom to convince spirit that it needs to go along with this repackaging nonsense. That's really disastrous. Not ultimately so, but in terms of needless delay, it's tragic. It's tragic. So it is a super uber serious situation right now. And the thing is, there's almost nobody who has this sense of urgency about it. I mean, just everyone around me, around that I'm aware of in this area, there doesn't seem to be even the faintest iota of awareness about this at all. And if you were to express this, they'd say you're absolutely nuts. You're just some kind of cultist kook or something. What do you mean? Preparing for what? Supernature. What? It's just utter nonsense. So the attitude, the brainwashing of the world, this is a brainwashed world at this point. Severely by the repackagers. In alliance with the corporations, corporate princess culture. Yeah, this is great for the corporations, great for the world. Let's all focus on trying to make this world a lovely place. Comfortable place. Let's work on the repackaging of madness, actually. This world is an expression of insanity, and it doesn't matter what kind of lipstick you put on that pig, it doesn't cure the insanity at all. Okay, so there is a definite way to cure the insanity, which is the spiritual path and evaporating the continuity fear. If this isn't done, you will just continue to desperately try and, you know, gloss it out, you know, try to, the insanity remains, which is ultimately the continuity fear remains, which is you're terrified of indeterminacy. You're terrified of what you are. And so you keep trying to change it, and it doesn't work. So you feel this futility also. You're terrified of what you are, you're terrified of the futility, and you fall into just this depression of just like, I just want to be annihilated. You know, I can't take this. You know, just I'm scared of what I am, and I'm engaging in futility. This doesn't work. I'm so tired of this. And if you're not aware if there's the spiritual path or the culture of it, spiritual attainment is not present, then what do? You see, so. Anyway, everyone should be very glad and happy that there are those who are graduating. This is the way it's supposed to be. In a culture of spiritual attainment, for instance, when I was a lower classman in the lower phases, I greatly appreciated the upperclassmen and those who had graduated. I held them in the highest regard, the highest esteem. I sought their counsel. It's like if you went to high school and imagine if the seniors, each senior chose a freshman, okay, and they act for the whole year, they're going to act as your advisor, be a freshman advisor, and school you in all the difficulties, all the whole situation of the high school, and protect you, look out for you. This is how it's supposed to be. I mean, I went to high school, it was nothing like that. The seniors looked down on us as like, we, you know, maggots, you know. We were just like nothing. It was horrible, absolutely horrible. No, the seniors should look at the freshmen like, say, wow, glad to have you in phase one here. This is fantastic. Remember, there are four phases to the spiritual path leading to the fifth supernature, the fifth phase, or the four phases of here that we think of on Earth as we have to get that done. So we liken to like a high school freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior. So this culture of spiritual attainment is when the upperclassmen welcome the lowerclassmen and help them out, welcome, make them feel at home, show them what needs to be done, encourage them, maybe, you know, and be advised and be supportive. And likewise, the lowerclassmen have great respect for the upperclassmen, support them in every way possible, and you know, and celebrate their, you know, their attainment, and keep their eye on the prize, and so it's a mutually supportive situation going on. This is what works. This is what has to be in place. You have to have this. You cannot battle your way through without any help. I mean, from all my reverence for the upperclassmen and those who have graduated, and focusing and trying to support in every way my whole life, you know, I got help. I got help from those who have already graduated. I don't know if I received help from any of the upperclassmen, seniors or not. Maybe indirectly in some way, yeah. That's what gave me access. And when you become a senior, you get access, more access to higher teachings, higher explanation. But it didn't go as smoothly as I would have liked, that's for sure, because it seems like this culture of spiritual attainment is being, you know, sabotaged and broken down now. In India, they seem to have had that for a long time. In Tibet, and various places in the world that are, you know, where, you know, it's so you're the upperclassmen bring you to meet their teacher, and you say hello, and they you know, take you around to various meditational places, and they just help you, ease you into the culture like that. And it's like, wow, that makes it so much easier, actually, so much easier. And I grew up thinking that's going to happen in the West. You know, I grew up on Yogananda's autobiography of a yogi in terms of culture. And he just said, no, this is the way the culture is. He showed us the culture that was the spiritual culture of India. He opened the door on it. And it's just like, wow. I mean, for example, Yogananda was at his school, and I think at Ranchi or something, helping educate young children into the spiritual path. You know, these are those who would grow up maybe in phase one in stream enterers, as they say in Buddhism, and would get started. So they taught meditation, calmness, all the right things that you need for a culture of spiritual attainment. And so one day, you know, Yogananda was there and overseeing stuff, and a car arrives. I guess they got some advance notice, but anyway, a car arrives, and out of the car steps this little old lady, and she comes over to, you know, to Yogananda and greets and strolls about the school, and the kids get to see her, and it was just like a beautiful visit. Everyone felt completely blessed by it, you know. And then she got in the car and then left. Who was that little old lady? That was Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, just showed up and to bless the situation. This is a spirit culture of spiritual attainment. Yeah, and Yogananda wrote about in the books, it was just like absolutely amazing, amazing blessing. But there are those who, you know, just show up. It's a whole culture of spiritual attainment. And that's just, the West is like devoid of that, almost devoid of that, almost devoid. Not entirely, they still try to, you know, but it's the intensity. For instance, in church last Sunday, the priest said, I'd just like to mention that there's a young man so-and-so who is following me around all this week, whatever. He's seriously considering becoming a priest, and so he's just getting a feel for, you know, what it's like to go through all this stuff. He's just like my shadow tagging me around. That's just a wise thing to do. Now for a week, you know, that's you know, it's a little thing, it's a tiny little thing. But it's a far cry from a real full-fledged culture of spiritual attainment. You get the bishop coming by occasionally and stuff like that. But you know, in India, Yogananda says you have these spiritual masters showing up. You have access to them. I mean, Nisargadatta Maharaj, he met a friend. He was working as a merchant selling cigarettes and stuff. And he met a friend, and his friend said, "Hey, I'm going to see my spiritual master, and would you like to come along?" And he said, "Yeah, I've been kind of thinking like lately. I've been kind of thinking about some things have been coming up in my mind that I kind of feel like I'm sort of attracted to spiritual, something spiritual right now." And so he said, "Well, come on, visit my master." Well, he takes them to some house there, and come in, and they spend some time, and the master tells them to focus on saying, you know, something like "I am" or something like that, and that's it. And Sargadatta just practiced this, and within 4 years or something, he's free of duality. He met a spiritual master. Just his friend just brought him over there. And so, see, I grew up on the belief that this is the way things should be. And so I kept waiting for the West. I kept waiting for it to happen. It never happened. It never happened here like that. It's like a complete shock. Where's our culture of spiritual attainment here? Well, it's in a different way. For instance, I walked into a bookstore back in 1978. I used to go there a lot. I didn't have any money. I'd go into bookstores and read for free. And you know, these stores had books the library didn't have. So I get all the newest arrivals of spiritual books, and I just spent hours and hours just standing there reading. And the people are very tolerant. They understand. This is good, I guess. But I literally, that's where I'd hang out at bookstores and read. Quickly, I know how to go through and find the meat of something, you know. And I came across, I was about ready to leave. I was going down the stairs of the loft, which is the really heavy spiritual stuff. And thousands of beautiful spiritual books, you know. And then I saw this three-volume set of blue books. I hadn't seen them before. I said, what in the world is that? And they stood out like, and I put one off and I kind of leafed through it and was reading it, and it's like, wow, what is this? What is this? And it struck me just like a thunderbolt, you know, thunderclap, thunderbolts, wow. I left, didn't have the money for it. I said, wow. And I started having these dreams that were like just pestering me hideously, putting pressure on me horribly. And finally I said, I'm not going to have any peace of mind after a month of this. I'm not going to have any peace of mind until I go get those books. So somehow I managed to scrap together enough money to get the books, probably my last money on earth, and went in and bought the books as A Course in Miracles. And I started reading and haven't stopped since. That was 1978. I haven't stopped considering the ideas. Eventually, I went beyond that into Journey Beyond Words, and then beyond that into examining my value of the world. But the transmission, you know, was there. So the transmission began at that point, 1978. So that's a different way than having some master, you know, show up. I mean, in India, there's all these religious festivals constantly, and satsangs and meditations. I mean, you know, you just go there, and there's, you know, high spiritual teachers there, and it. But here, it's not like that. So, I had this book instead of, you know, a teacher, but the book was my teacher, and so that's how it's gone. I haven't really been in the presence of, and been introduced to any spiritual teachers in the world at all. And because they're just not, there isn't the same culture. So I don't know what's going to happen next. It seems like we really could use a boost in some way. Being ready to graduate, which I feel I am, I should be able to start, you know, interacting with previous graduates. It would certainly seem that way. I don't have too much more I need to do in terms of clarifying. You know, I've done my clarification work. So I would like to start rubbing elbows with some of previous graduates and sort of get ready for graduation. And find out what that's all about, actually. I did. The Dalai Lama was like giving some talk in San Jose in some auditorium, and someone had tickets, they invited me, and I went. And so during this intermission, everybody's sitting there very reverentially, and Dalai Lama was talking to somebody on stage, real high stage, you know, it's like about an 8-foot stage or so. For some reason, I got out of my seat. Nobody else was doing this. I just got out of my seat and I just walked all the way down to the front of the stage. And the Dalai Lama was talking to someone in, you know, a Buddhist robes, you know, chatting away. And I was just looking at the Dalai Lama. I was like, huh, I want to look at him. And he turned around to me and looked at me and started, and burst out in laughter. He just burst out in laughter. I just walked, you know, and now that was it. That was it. And then I just said, wow. Then went back to my seat. Pretty interesting. So maybe that was the transmission. Very appropriate. I don't know if he thought I was funny that I was looking at him, you know, or it was some sort of just, you know, wordless transmission of freedom, you know. But okay, yeah, that was it. And, but that was quite a long time ago. So, but now I'm kind of like, you know, I have understanding of Tibetan Buddhism through Longchenpa, kind of understand the apex yoga and just have sort of like, appreciation, understanding of the situation. And, I'm still going. I'm going with what you know, the original transmission framework that I use. But I understand that there are other ways to stylize it and talk about it. But it's pointing to the same freedom. Pointing to the same freedom, absolutely. For instance, Longchenpa and Jesus are pointing to the same freedom, exactly the same freedom. As is Ananda Maima, the same freedom, absolutely. There's just different cultures, different ways of stylizing, of talking about it, of conceptualizing it, different ways. Just, that's how it is. And just don't get tripped up on any of that. It's perfectly okay to favor some style, absolutely. You don't need to be someone who tries to synthesize all styles or something like that. No, just have tolerance for it. Don't be bothered by it. The whole goal is to minimize delay, not to increase it. Because as Longchenpa says, is really, the goal of Buddhism is to transcend Buddhism. And Jesus said the same thing. The goal of A Course in Miracles is to transcend A Course in Miracles, actually. Transcend all the words, transcend all the concepts, transcend all the teachings, teachers, all form, whatever. Transcend it all. So as they say, radical Dzogchen is not really Buddhism at all. It's basically saying you don't need Buddhism. But that is only apropos once you've gotten to the point where realizing that you don't need Buddhism, it doesn't bother you, it doesn't cause you to freak out or backslide. Just like Christianity, getting to the point where you realize you don't need any merit. It's impossible. There's never even an issue of merit whatsoever with God. But up until that time, you're desperately trying to accumulate merit, you see. And so you go through the phases and eventually realize you don't need to accumulate any merit, which means you don't need this world at all, you see. We optimistically view this world as a place where we can attain merit. And this is putting the spiritual path in a dualistic context. We think, how do I, you know, what we're trying to do is lose merit with God. We're trying to change what we are. And then we decide, wow, I don't want to really do that anymore. What we do is automatically, we stay in dualism. We say, okay, I was trying to lose merit before, so now I need to gain it back, whatever I lost. We automatically assume that we've lost merit, that we've changed what we are. Somehow we've gotten on the wrong side of God. We've got a deficit. We're in debt to God because that we were trying to do so. And so we don't give up the whole context, the premise. We say, keep the premise, and we say, okay, let me see how I can accumulate merit then. And then you realize, wow, I need to have like perfect merit. How do I do that? And they say, okay, well, maybe in the sacrifice of Jesus will give me perfect merit or something. But then eventually then you have to realize, I never lost any merit at all. In fact, there's no issue of merit at all. I'm perfect, and God's always seen me as absolutely perfect. I don't need any merit at all. It's a non-issue. It's a non-issue. And then we think, well, what about all the merit I accumulate? You don't accumulate merit, actually. So the apex yoga, the high fourth phase, is the realization you never acquired any merit at all. No one has. No one needs to. But for someone who believes their salvation is based on merit, how can they realize they don't have any merit? You see what I'm saying? So when you ask, well, why is it difficult to just jump into the apex yoga teaching? The Advaita Vedanta, the end of the Vedantas, the fourth phase, the journey beyond words. This is why. Is we have believed that accumulating merit is how we gain salvation. Then how can we suddenly shift to a position of recognition that we've never accumulated any merit whatsoever. In fact, it's impossible to accumulate merit. That'll freak us out, wouldn't it? And say, oh my God, I'll never be saved. See, I'm never going to be saved. Oh my gosh, I'm back to ground zero. And not only that, it's impossible to be saved. Then, you know, you just go into depression or something. It's just hideous. So, that's why the path is difficult. Path is difficult. Let's not fool ourselves, okay, on this. This is what should be said to the freshmen. This is why as a senior classman, I'm talking to not only other senior classmen, the whole class, all four phases, including the freshmen and those who are going to be freshmen, and saying, it is not easy. It is going to be difficult. The path is very difficult because you have this inner dread. You think you're going to lose something vitally important. In the back of your mind, you feel like maybe all this merit, I didn't really get it. I haven't really gotten merit. And you're worried about seeing this, you know, that as if that's going to just ruin you forever. And it's not true at all, as we just pointed out. We never lost any merit. We never lost any ground with God. We never sinned against God. We never dishonored God. We're not. So everything's perfect. Always has been. Always will be. So we don't need any merit. We don't need to accumulate merit. We don't need this world to accumulate merit, you see. That's why we hold on to this world. We think, wow, I've got to be in this terrible place so I can try to make it better. I can try to do better things and try to, you know, improve, get merit. In supernature, there's no way to accumulate merit, you see. This is why we're afraid of supernature. Is you get there, and then you gradually realize, wow, everything's perfect. There's no way I can do anything, make it better or anything. I can't accumulate merit here. And then you start getting nervous, like, oh, God, how can I be saved then? So, obviously, you have to graduate, be a graduate of the fourth phase in order to get into supernature, where it doesn't bother you that there's no way to accumulate any merit. See, it's like that. So the path is difficult. You put the path in a dualistic context automatically when you start out. Oh, I said, oh my gosh, I sinned against God so terribly. Well, how do I gain merit to erase that all that's terrible sin? And then you work, and gradually you start realizing, maybe I don't even need to do this. And then you're shaky and frightened, you know, there's this consternation. That's the burn. And so the fourth phase is just full stop in the burn. We're not even evaluating it. We understand what it's about. So we're just consciously allowing the burn to happen. So the path might be said to be working with this burn. It's like, oh my gosh, I can never earn this merit. Guess what? You don't need to. And they say, well, somebody's got to pay the price. No, there is no price to pay. We never, ever, ever made determinacy real for even one instant. Not even one instant has ever been determinate, and never will be. So we never affected reality in the slightest bit. And again, how in the world can I say all this stuff? Because I had great teachers and great teachings, that's why. Why did I get those? Because I was determined to succeed and willing to put in the effort to do so, that's why. And there was a culture of spiritual attainment in various places in the world, which somehow seeped through to me and was able to get enough reassurance from that to go for it. And just gradually evaporating this fear, working with the burn, full stop in the burn. Fourth phase is just full stop in the burn. The other phases, 1, 2, and 3, is adjustments to the burn, you know, rituals. Or how do I deal with this burn? You know, this burn, the burning up of the idea of merit. You know, hey, how do I deal with this? And so different phases. And the fourth phase is just indeterminate. You're not doing anything. Just full stop in the burn. Not even trying to answer it or anything. Do anything. Just let it burn. No merit. I don't know. Maybe. maybe, 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 maybe. See, that's no merit, no merit, no merit, maybe, maybe, maybe. And of course, they're inside, they're just like the structure of merit is just shaking and trembling and melting and disintegrating. And just let it burn, just let it burn. So the repackagers are here in this world, and those on the spiritual path are prior to the path, they're desperately trying to gain merit. And then the first stage of the path is introduction, like maybe you can't gain merit. For instance, like Catholicism or Christianity is basically, you're taught like, you know, there's nothing you can do to gain merit actually in the eyes of God. But I say, but don't worry, Jesus did it for you. That's like, you might call the first phase, okay? Which is, so, yeah, the first phase is to realize you cannot attain the necessary merit. This is just a first step. And the second step is to say, hey, maybe you don't need to attain merit. Merit's not needed. Maybe merit's not needed at all. Maybe you didn't do anything. And then that's a real difficult phase, like very difficult phase. So how is that possible? And you have to work through that. And the third phase is you start seeing more clearly. You realize fundamentally, you know what, it is true. It is true. I don't need any merit. That's the third phase. But you're still intellectualizing. Yeah, I know it's true, but I don't know what to do about this. Fourth phase is you start actually practicing. You really burn up all the remaining consternation, the whole structure of a merit-based belief system. Is you just let it disintegrate. Just full stop, indeterminacy. That's the fourth phase. So those are the phases. So I'm not critical of the first phase. I'm just clarifying it, what it is, okay? I'm not critical of religion. I'm just telling you to be wise and understand the situation. Is the first step is you have to take a step and say, something like merit just isn't possible for me. You know, as you start detaching from this whole meritocracy, this belief we can attain merit, have to take that step. But being still dualistic, you're still saying, but somehow I still need it, but I can't do it for myself. You see, it's a very important step. So Christianity is a very important step for people to take, actually. Our religions that have this, you know, of my own merit, I cannot do it. It's not possible. And for quite some time, they will keep believing that, but Jesus can get the merit for me. That somehow there's a payment that needs to be made to God, a substitutionary, God's honor needs to be restored, depending on what doctor of philosophy, what theory you go on. But it all boils down to the same thing, that some sort of restitution has to be made, okay? So, but you can't do it. That's the first step. That's the first step. Again, the second step is then you start saying, wow, you know, this, I really have to dig into this. How come it's not working for me? I got to find out why. Deeper understanding is coming. And then you study the theory and the explanations, and you gradually sort out and say, you know what? I kind of feel like it's likely that it's, you know, no restitution has to be made. Get the theory behind that. The third phase is when you really clarify and you're convinced. You're convinced to say, no restitution has to be made. I'm absolutely convinced of that. Absolutely convinced of it. And then you work on your valuing of the world and trying to detach from the whole valuing of merit altogether. You know, you work on that, worked on that for like 15 years or so. And then the fourth phase comes in where you just burn all the remaining structure, belief structure, let it disintegrate. You get into real practice where you just full stop in the burn, full stop in the burn practice in phase four. That's phase four. I didn't do that in phase three. I was more examining my value of the world very intensely and thinking, you know, it's not that big of a deal if I'm not really engaged with this world. I don't really find any merit in it anyway. So how can I really attain merit here? I don't see any merit actually anywhere. And then phase four, then this is an intense practice, which is what we're doing here. And then once that's completed, then phase five is will reveal itself. but we got to make sure that we complete phase four. Phase four is the end of belief. The whole belief system is gone, and we realize don't need that. Don't even need the belief system. Don't need the world. Don't need the belief system behind the world at all. We'll exchange it for supernature, where no, it's obvious no merit is possible because everything's already perfect. So obviously you can't take a phase one, some of the phase one into supernature, because they will say, "What? There's no chance for merit at all here. You know, how's this possible?" It'll be very confusing to them. So we have to go through these phases: phase one, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. It gets us to the fifth, which is supernature. So I'm being called to supernature, no question. Subtle miracles in the world, I'm noticing stuff that's just pretty amazing. It's like that elevator dream. Yeah, I'm going up to the fifth floor now. I said, all right, great. We'll do that, and then let those who want to go down to the basement, let them go down there to one, ground one or two, or basement, one or two, which means phase one, phase two. The ones in the elevator there wanted to go to phase one, phase two, some maybe zero. They weren't ready to start yet. But, you know, I was ready to go up to phase five. And I think the closing the door of the elevator is just a sign of the times. Closing the door on the awareness of this culture of spiritual attainment. And I saw it. I realized, no. I'm not going to allow this. I'm going to allow in this fifth dimensional, this phase five being that was their friend. And we're going to go up to the fifth level here, fifth phase. But the door certainly did close, three of them. Boom, boom, boom. Very, very imposing closing of those doors. It wasn't just one elevator door. It was an outer, a middle, and an inner door. They'd all close shut. And I just like threw myself into those doors and just clawed them open. Pushed him open. But you imagine your phase two, and someone like Sri Anandamayi Ma comes by, and you realize there's a very presence of indeterminateness, actually. And something in you just goes, wow, that's really cool. It's really cool. And, you know, then you got some inspiration to say, I just got to really keep working at this. Don't give up. Something about in this indeterminateness I really like. I really got this feeling, like this is something like I really want it. So there are some in the world in phase one, some in the world are in phase two. There may be some in phase three, and there may be some in phase four. Numerically, it gets a lot less as you go up to phase four. And who knows who they are? Don't know. But scattered here and there, doing their own practice, etc. I'm sure that there are some scattered around, yeah. And as far as who the graduates are, I'm not sure. We'll have to wait and find out. I don't know the teachers in this world exactly what their disposition is. Not really. Are they upperclassmen? Have they graduated? I don't know. We'll see. But this is not important. What's important is to keep the burn going. Keep the full stop and the burn going. And for those in phase 1, 2, and 3, pay attention. Pay attention. For example, I always had, you know, respect for the upperclassmen. This is, wow, this is way beyond what I'm able to understand. And that's, you know, all respect to that. You know, it's like that. You don't have to compete. You just have to stay steady as possible. The key in the spiritual path is to become more and more steady at it. That's the difficulty. It's a discipline. Keep on steadying it out. Steady, 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 smooth, steady, smoother, steady, smoother, steady, smoother, like that. Gradually, gradually, gradually. It seems like I started this life in phase 2. So it is possible to go through phase 2, 3, and 4 in a lifetime. Because I already knew that the whole story of substitutory merit and all this stuff, I already knew this wasn't so. So that'd be phase 1, you see. So likely started out in phase 2, having already done phase 1 in previous lives. It's likely. Because I already knew there was a higher explanation, so I was just focused on what that higher explanation is. I was not resting in the idea, oh, I need merit, but you know, Jesus did it for me. I said, no, there's a higher teaching than that. See, most phase oneers believe they die and the merit of Jesus covers them and they go to heaven and they're happy forever after. So they're not too worried. They just say, all I have to do is believe this and I'll be saved. No problem. But when they find themselves being returning to this world, then they say, wait a minute. Wait a minute, what happened? And that's when the likelihood is to start go to phase 2. They say, hey, I thought I was permanent. It only turned out to be a vacation. It's like when people go on vacation and they come back home and everything's the same back home. Oh, I didn't want to come back home. But they say, oh, it's good to get back home. But is it really? You know, coming back to that, is it really? All the problems are there, all the patterns are there. And they fall right back into the same old patterns of behavior and everything is still the same. They say, oh, God, it's horrible. I know a lot of people, of course, they say this world's horrible, they don't want to come back, but they're not willing to do the work while they're here to assure that they don't come back. You can't have it both ways like that. It's basically by not doing the work, you're assuring that you come back. So this is the ambivalence. It's ambivalence. You say, what happens if you believe in merit is in the afterlife, gradually you don't really go to the clear light and abide in the clear light. You might have a glimpse of it, but it's too much for you. So, continuity fear. And then you say, my merit wasn't enough. I need to go back to this world to accumulate more merit. So there's a whole belief system that we're in generates both nature and the afterlife, both. So, of course, you'll ask people, and they'll say, you didn't have enough merit. You need to go back and accumulate more merit. And you go, okay. And so you find yourself back here thinking you need to accumulate more merit. You're upset. You say, I thought I had enough merit. I thought Jesus, I need to believe in Jesus more then because somehow I didn't get enough merit. You know? And it may go through many lifetimes like that, actually, in the first phase. Keep thinking, I need to to somehow, you know, I'm not quite accepting Jesus enough, or why, you know, kind of thing. And then eventually you dig deeper. And you start to hear about this phase situation, and then you say, oh, okay, it's okay. I needed that. See, you need step one. So don't condemn yourself. I don't condemn anybody for believing in substitutionary atonement. I'm not condemning them. I'm just clarifying it. It helps a lot when you're able to see these phases. And you forgive yourself. Say, well, I needed to crawl before I could walk. That's okay. I needed to get the idea that I couldn't generate sufficient merit. You see, it's not possible for me. But you still hold on to the idea of merit. And then the second step, you say, well, maybe the whole idea of merit isn't true. Let me look at this more carefully. That's what I did. That's phase two. And then phase three is you draw the conclusion, no, it's not needed. It's not needed. But then you say, well, what the heck do I do with this world? And wow, what will, you know? And then phase four is the clarification of the entire situation and the burn, full stop, indeterminacy, and getting comfortable with that. And so that's how it goes. That's how it goes. So wherever you are, just forgive yourself for the previous step. You know, forgive yourself for the previous step. And say, I was just crawling then. That's great. That's really great. So I support the whole path, all phases. So I still I go to church. And I understand this is phase one stuff, and all the teachings phase one. I'm just observing there and say, okay. It's helpful. It's essential. You have to crawl before you can walk. Walk before you can run. Run before you can fly. And fly before you realize you're everywhere. You don't even need to fly because you're already there. That's what the fifth phase leads to. You could call that a sixth phase. And the seventh, you could say there's a seventh phase where you come back to this world or something like that. But that's all speculative and not something that can really be conceptualized at all, actually. Not really conceptualized at all. The fifth phase is the finishing phase. It's the finishing phase. So we are just interested in phase one, two, three, and four. That's it. That gets us to the fifth. So there are those who go to church and thinking that the they have the beliefs that their merit that they can't pay is being paid by someone else in some way. Or is being diminished, or, you know, or someone's making a bargain with God in some way. And what often happens is, for instance, in phase one, like in Catholicism, or Christianity, is Catholicism especially, is like they realize, wow, Jesus is I still haven't got the payment. God has not been paid. The ransom has not been paid. The redemption has not been made. Restitution has not been made. What's wrong with Jesus? Maybe. God's not listening to him, or he's not working. So what they do is they turn to the Virgin Mary and say that she can get the deal with God. You see, that Jesus doesn't have quite enough, but she can bring the extra amount there, the restitution, or she can cut a deal with God where Jesus is not quite able to do it, or something. So you get a lot of that shifting over to the mother goddess image of Virgin Mary, your mother goddess image, and thinking that, you know, Virgin of Guadalupe, etc., that she can get the deal done. That doesn't work either, of course. Then you say, wow, now what? You say, now what? Or in finding out that the restitution doesn't happen, even by putting faith in Jesus, that still doesn't happen. Then you get really worried and you say, wow, I better just make this world a great place then, because it doesn't look like I can ever, I can't generate the merit myself, and someone else can't do it for me. What do I do? I've got to make this world a wonderful place. And then you start worshiping the goddess, Mother Nature, goddess, and doing what she says, which is, well, let's plant flowers everywhere, my children. And we must sweep the streets clean and keep everything clean, plant the flowers, make, you know, trim the trees real nicely, plant trees everywhere. Let's be happy. Let's be happy. Let's clean up the planet. Let's make it a really wonderful place here. And you get sucked into worshiping the Mother Goddess, which is the ego in disguise, which is the belief system of trying to really destroy what we are, which is really the belief system of death. Try to make death beautiful. Try to put, you know, glossier lipstick on the pig is what happens. So you can get caught up in that, even in the second phase. There's vestiges of that will continue on. You think like, wow, you know, this is scary. Maybe I need to get merit. Or maybe this is not going to work. Maybe not having any merit at all isn't going to work, so I better, you know, make the world a beautiful place. So you can get caught up in that. I got caught up in that. I think that's pretty normal for people to say, well, if I can get merit and nobody can get merit for me, and then I'm being told I don't need any merit, and you say, you know, I just can't quite figure that out. I can't quite understand that. You say, I don't think I can get this. Is this too much? Then you feel like maybe I better make this world really beautiful. And you get, you know, suckered into that. That definitely can happen. And then eventually you go back and you start working at it, really put in another big burst of effort, and then you realize, wow, okay, now I get it, now I understand. Wow, okay, yes it is, no problem at all. Then you're less susceptible to the whole repackaging trend in the world. Less susceptible. I'm not saying you're still completely unsusceptible to it. So this is the testimony of one who's been through all of this. And it's quite difficult because there's ambivalence, there's fear, there's ambivalence, continuity fear. And it's, again, a culture of attainment is super helpful. And discipline is super helpful. Working at it every day is super helpful. Every day you should try to understand. You've got to have faith that there's definitely an explanation, there's a clarification. You don't need to try to make this world a perfect place, a beautiful place. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. That's merit. It's both trying to gain merit and hedging your bets, thinking, well, I probably can't ever gain enough merit, so this is going to be my permanent home, so I better make it something I really enjoy. Both of those are false hope. So you should try to realize there is a clarification, there is an explanation. You can get it. You absolutely will get it. So every day you have to try. You have to put aside all your efforts and just get into this indeterminacy as much as possible and saying, I'm not going to do anything for this time or hour, or just try to hear the highest teachings I can, and just commit yourself to that. Because for sure, as you go in this world, you'll get caught up here and there with all this boosterism of repackaging and fear that, you know, you do have to get some merit, or maybe you can't succeed, so you have to make this world enjoyable to you. You'll get caught up in that to the various degrees. So the discipline is every day you have to drop whatever you're doing and just full stop in the indeterminateness here. And that will inoculate you from all this. It will protect you from it. No answers. Don't worry about answers. Just get used to indeterminateness. And when you do that, then the answers will, the clarification will arise within you automatically. Jesus said, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. Well, to a little extent, is you simply full stop on the indeterminateness. Of course you're going to feel a burn there. Of course you'll feel the burn. It's like, I'm not gaining merit. I'm not making the world better. I'm not gaining merit. I'm not making the world better. Just go on the faith of those who've graduated. I've told you. The clarity will arise within you. When you practice like this and you get used to move your comfort zone into freedom, you'll see then, suddenly you'll see, oh, I never did, nothing's ever happened to reality. So I don't need any merit at all. Nobody does. Not only do I not need merit, nobody does. This is the higher realization. This is what really helps, is to see, not only do I not need to accumulate merit, nobody does. Therefore, I don't have to be trapped into trying to build up excessive merit myself to pay off others' debt to God. You see, this is very important. The vision of oneness is you realize, you just see that nobody is in debt to God. No one is. There's no need for the slightest merit for anyone whatsoever. That's what really frees you. Because you don't have to spend your time accumulating merit for anybody. Not at all. You spend your time explaining the situation, clarifying it, helping clarify it. But you don't have to be attaining merit at all. Therefore, you can be dwelling in a portable paradise of supernature, even while you're here in this world, where everything's perfect, where you don't see the slightest option for merit at all. Now, it's difficult to understand all these phases and be able to deal with all these phases simultaneously. That's something like a really high teacher can do. But for our purpose, we're just sort of clarifying it. We're not going out there and trying to, like in church at phase one, I'm not saying anything. I'm not offering any advice to anybody. I don't talk at all. Just be quiet. Just observe. Because the reactions of phase oneers are, you have to really be so utterly, totally at peace in freedom and love and clarity to be able to be have absolute flexibility of indeterminacy to be able to deal with the situation in such a way. Absolute flexibility of indeterminacy. And as someone who's still in the fourth phase, that's not there at all. Even in the fifth phase, that's not there. So we need not worry about trying to change people's minds here or trying to help too much here. What we're trying to do is graduate. And don't worry about everyone else. There is a path. There is a way. Absolutely there is. It's inevitable. Inevitable. And nobody needs to gain any merit at all. So don't worry about people. Don't think they're going to fail. It's impossible to fail. If you don't need to gain any merit, how can you fail? You may see people just so upset. I can't gain enough merit. I just can't have enough faith that my, I'm gonna be paid. My debt to God is going to be paid, and I'm worried. And they're all worried. But do you share their worry? You know that no merit is needed at all. So do you empathize with them? Do you sympathize, or empathize, or maybe sympathize, but not empathize? You don't feel the same worry, because that'll just make it worse for them. They'll say, oh, so you agree with me. Oh my gosh, you agree that, yeah, I'm going to fail to get the merit I need. So, to help out in this world in a real profound way is to show everybody that you have no concern whatsoever. about anyone. No, sympathetic, I don't. Maybe that's what the Dalai Lama's laugh was. Maybe I have someone saying, I'm in so much trouble, how can I ever succeed? And he burst out laughing, you know. See, there's no worries. You don't need to succeed as far as in merit goes, you know. There's no need for that for anybody. So we need to drop this dread about others, like somehow they may not be saved. You know, in phase oneers, they're very much into saying, well, if you don't accept Jesus and the payment, the restitution that Jesus made to God, you're going to fail and be damned to hell forever. And so they're really worried about everyone saying, my gosh, you know, you, once the judgment's made, you're going to fail and you'll be annihilated. You know, that's from their standpoint. But ultimately, you realize no merit is needed at all whatsoever. Not even a single instant has ever been determinate. So we completely fail to change what we are. So there's no trouble at all. Nobody has any trouble. So nobody's ever going to be lost at all. It's impossible. In fact, right even this very instant, they're completely saved. In fact, it's not beyond even saved. There's no even notion of being saved at all. There's no such thing as not being saved. So saved, not saved is dualistic. There's no trouble at all. There's never been any trouble. Everything is perfect. That's it's always been. That's the case right now for everyone. And it never changes. So the real top teachers in the world, they know this and they just radiate this complete blissful reassurance to everybody. Yeah, you know, people pick that up and they get very relieved, like, wow. But it's not relief so much that on their part, partially, but they also start to realize, hey, everybody else is safe too, is reassured too. See, like, hey, maybe it's all okay for everybody. Then this starts taking you into higher, you know, considerations, phase 2, 3, 4. Those who graduate, do they forget all about the undergraduates? No, no, no. Why would they do that? They're very aware of this struggle they have, the dualistic struggle and the fear of lack of merit, not finding a way to make things right, and they're not quite yet convinced that nothing ever went wrong. It's very seemingly difficult to get that for sure. I know it is. Still need to work at all this, so of course you have compassion for all the undergraduates, absolutely. But you don't empathize with it, you don't realize, you don't feel this fear of failure. Since nothing's ever gone wrong at all, how could there be any such thing as failure? Yeah, there's never such anything as failure, how could there be anything as success, really? Except to burn off this continuity fear, right? Evaporate it. But that is not real success. What it is just realization. You don't need any success because failure is impossible. Success is also impossible. Nothing's ever gone wrong. So there's not a question of, when I say failure is impossible, that means, okay, that means I will succeed. No. I mean that neither failure nor success is possible. Don't need either. Nothing ever went wrong. Again, for instance, the great witness to all this, Sri Nanamayama, people would say, thank you for helping make it better, make it. And she said, what are you talking about? She always said, no, everything's already perfect. Everything's completely perfect. Every moment is totally perfect. There's no making it better or making it right or anything like that. This is true. But admittedly, in you're in phase 1, 2, and 3, and even 4 is like, you know, struggling with that. Don't struggle with the struggle, though. This is probably the best advice. Don't struggle with the struggle. Because for sure, there is going to be struggle on the path. A lot of struggle. Don't struggle with the struggle. Practice this not struggling with the struggle. This is key. You see, if you see people go to satsang or some teacher, that's what they're doing. They're struggling. Of course, you can see they're struggling. Like, what are they saying? What's being said here? I don't get it. You know, is it this? They're struggling. Don't struggle with the struggle. Is you stay poised, you stay confident, you stay feeling like, you know, eventually this will dawn upon me, and this is helping me get there, and this is burning off a continuity fear. This is really the key. Don't struggle with the struggle. Don't give up the struggle. Just don't struggle with it. And how you can do to actually practice this is discipline. It is day, moment by moment discipline. Every day, the struggle will be there every day. And so you just have to accept the struggle of that day. Don't struggle with it, but be convinced that answers will arise that day. Answers will come, clarity will come. You'll continue to be disciplined. Don't lose your temper. Don't lose your poise. Don't get frustrated. That's what I mean. Don't struggle with the struggle. If you're experiencing all this, you know, boiling over and losing your cool and all this stuff, which I actually did yesterday during the World Series game with the Giants. Giants are on the brink of losing control of the World Series and going down to defeat, really. And I think it was the second inning, third inning, and I was just like ready to turn off the game. Said, I'm finished. They're finished. I got so angry. I got so upset. But all this training, I said, you know what? I'm going to hang in there. Because before the game started, I had a feeling they were going to win. And I said, even though it looks terrible right now, and it really did, I said, I just somehow feel they're going to come back. So I said, okay, this struggle they're going through is really scary, but they'll get through it somehow. And so I kept watching, and they came back with an incredible victory. So this is a great example. You know you're going to win, okay, on this path. You know you're going to win. I guarantee you for sure you are going to win this, okay? You're going to succeed. You're going to finish, so to speak. You're going to get it. You're going to get to fifth phase. So with that in mind, don't lose your cool. Don't lose your cool. Don't turn off. Don't quit. You know, don't quit. Don't lose your cool. Just say, hey, the more I practice this indeterminateness and calm, even in the don't struggle to struggle, the quicker I'm going to succeed. So I'm just going to keep doing this. So I put it into action there. I was really, really cursing out the manager and the player. What are you doing? Can you not see? Don't you know that this is going to help? Because I knew ahead of time. I kind of feel. But he did eventually got it right. You know, just a little slower than I would like. And stuff all clicked in place. And it was like beautiful. Unless you're a Kansas City fan or something. So, don't lose your cool. Absolutely do not lose your cool. Make that the number one priority. Do not struggle with the struggle. Because what happens when you struggle with the struggle, you lose your cool. You say, oh my God, I'm struggling so terrible. I'm never going to get it. This is just not working. No, just say, oh, okay, indeterminacy here. I'll just be calm. I won't struggle with it. And then you say, hey, I am getting it. Look how good I am. Look at this. Isn't this amazing? This tremendous turmoil of feeling like I can't make enough merit on my own, and nobody can get enough merit for me, and I may never be able to succeed at this, and maybe I don't need merit, but maybe I do. Maybe I should make the world a better place. I'm not sure. Just smile and say, oh, this is great. Great opportunity to practice here. Great opportunity to practice. Don't struggle with the struggle. Fantastic. Wonderful. And it's always good to have somebody remind you, don't worry, they're going to win. Don't worry, you're going to win. Don't worry, you're going to win. That's very helpful, actually, very helpful. That's why I say a culture of attainment is very, very helpful, because you have examples of those who have succeeded, and they'll tell you, you will succeed. Don't worry, you will succeed. I've had teachers tell me that in dreams, in sleep. It's, you're going to succeed. Don't worry. For sure you will. I was Ramana Maharshi. That's right, in a dream. I was really just about ready to quit. And in a dream, this being came up to me and just offered his opinion and told me, hey, he said, I've been watching what you're doing. And I know that you're feeling like it's really futile, you know, and it's never going to work, etc. But I can tell you for sure it's going to work, for sure. No, don't have any concern about that. I says, I can already see it. I already know it. You're going to succeed. And he told me so convincingly, I absolutely believed him. There's no reason not to. I could tell, he knew. And from that point on, I've really gone all out to succeed. That was like back in, I think like the year 2000 or something like that. That's all it took. He just convinced me that I was going to succeed. He said, don't give up. Don't give up. You can do it. You're going to do it. You're going to succeed. I already can see your future, your destiny, and you're going to be very helpful. So this is an example of a graduate, someone who's already graduated, coming back and talking to someone who's working through these phases and giving a big boost and saying, don't worry, I know you're going to succeed. Don't give up. Perfect example of the help, kind of help you get. This is the only time I've ever had any transmission from Ramana Maharshi. The only time. But, you know, he said, yeah, I can see you have a different style than mine. I says, that's fine. It's not a problem. He says, your style is just as good as mine. Don't worry. You know, just as good. Both are very effective. No worries. It will be very helpful for many people, this style. So just keep working on it. Keep working on it. Okay? You're going to succeed. I was overwhelmed. I said, wow, somebody telling me that like that. I didn't know who it was at the time. Later on, I saw a picture of Mama Harshi when he's younger, and it was the same person. I said, wow, that's who it was. So that's, again, someone who's graduated, coming back, helping out those who are struggling, you know, in high school. So we do have help. We absolutely do have help. So don't struggle with the struggle. Don't struggle with the struggle. For instance, when I lost my cool with the Giants, I just looked at it and said, okay, I'm losing my cool with the Giants. That's okay. Don't struggle with it. I just kind of had a laugh and said, okay, that's good. That's all right. This was not without reason here. And don't struggle with it. And then I kind of said, okay, kind of cool down. And said, all right, let's see what happens here. Looked like a disaster, absolute disaster. So you can get examples from your life. You know, life throws stuff at you, and you can practice. Don't struggle with the struggle. Don't flee from the struggle. Just don't struggle with it. Hang in there. You're going to succeed. You will succeed. Absolutely. No choice but to succeed, really. In fact, ultimately, again, there's not even a question of success or failure. Nothing ever happened. You're already perfect. Always have been. Right now, everyone is. So you can say you will succeed in seeing that everybody is already perfect and that nobody needs any success. You will succeed in seeing this. No sleep last night whatsoever. I ate a whole bunch of sunflower seeds watching the game. Super salty. I have a feeling that this super saltiness affected my system, and I just lay awake all night long. Yeah, it was really rough. So So I have a feeling at some point my battery's gonna go. I'm gonna go low battery here today. But at least got this tape again, you see. That's what's important. Don't wait until you have low battery to do your efforts. When you feel your best, that's when you really need to focus in and do the best you can. And then, you know, when you got low battery, take a nap or something. Don't use the time when you feel got some energy to go out and try to make the world a better place. Try to bring merit to yourself or to others. Okay, it's not needed. Work towards graduating, then you can encourage others to also do the same and to reach the realization that everything's perfect. It's always been perfect. No determinacy. There's no determinacy whatsoever. That means all is totally perfect. Everything is exactly as we want it to be, moment by moment by moment. We are not in the slightest bit bound by this moment. In our choosing of the next moment, and the next moment is completely free. All potentiality is totally available for us every single moment, and that will always be so. There's not the slightest potentiality that is ever taken away from us. Not one. The clear light always remains the clear light. The pure spaciousness always remains the pure spaciousness. This is all the ground of being. The ground of being always remains the ground of being, without us having to do anything about it to sustain it or to make it that way or anything whatsoever. So this is already the case. There is no pit. Nobody fell into any pit. It's all been a dream. Dreams are very convincing to the dreamer until they start waking up from it. So, just don't struggle with the struggle. And keep persisting, and we call help from all the graduates. All the graduates, please, time to show up. At the Giants baseball game, all the Hall of Famers show up. The old Hall of Famers from the Giants, they show up, you know, and encourage the guys. So we can call upon all those who have graduated from this false belief in determinacy, who no longer have any continuity fear, who realize that all is always perfect. We call upon all of them to pay us a visit. Rub shoulders, rub elbows. Come on, let's rub elbows. And let's start experiencing this indeterminacy. Let's get going on this. We got 20 months, okay? Time to really put the pedal down to the metal and get going on this. All right, don't struggle with the struggle. That's it.